views and opinions expressed in this program are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect the views of Bronxnet or the program underwriters.
Welcome, welcome, welcome. Hey, everyone, I'm the Doc Bobby. You're watching Open BXRX, another fantastic show in store for you. You know how we give it to you. Thank you so much for tuning in, and thank you so much for checking it all out. We have this coming up on today's show. We'll hear from a conflict resolution strategist about her perspective on the slap heard around the world. Then we'll speak to a musician to learn about his unique journey in the world of music and how his passion for stringed instruments was sparked. After that, we'll hear from the VP of marketing for the 2021 MLS Championship, and we'll shine a light on their latest jerseys. Plus, Bobby C has the latest in the world of sports. And then finally, we'll sit down with a deputy director of an organization committed to highlight an upcoming community event. All of this and more headed your way right here on Open. We're wide open, and you are welcome to the park. Hey, everyone, I'm the Dr. Bob Lee. I'm your host, and you're watching Open. It's that live interactive program that brings the Bronx and New York City straight to your TV set. You can stay connected to us through social media at BronxNet TV. A whole lot going on, I tell you. But leading things off, our first guest is a communication expert and conflict resolution strategist. And she's here to share her perspective on the Will Smith and Chris Rock incident. Yeah. And, you know, all that stuff that took place at the Oscars, and to highlight some important lessons that can be learned from this. So please welcome to the show, Lynn Hurdle Price. Lynn, welcome, welcome, welcome.
Oh, thank you so much. I'm so thrilled to be here. So, Lynn,
I know. Before we get started, tell us a little bit about your background and how you got into what you're into.
Absolutely. So I'm a conflict resolution strategist over 40 years now. And I'm in there in the trenches helping people with the everyday disputes to all of the heaviness of the disputes around race and all of the isms out there. And unfortunately, I was going to be a theater major, and I started in this work because of a racial incident that happened actually here in the Bronx. That's where I was born and raised. And it was an incident where I almost lost my life. And after the incident, right after, I remember saying, I don't know how, but I think my purpose is to bring people together around these issues. And so I went to Syracuse University and started my career.
Yeah, and then what do you think about, you know, everybody's still talking about it. The slap heard around the world. I mean, we want to put it to bed and get into other things, but people are still talking about it. And they're talking about, you know, maybe he needs to get some sort of therapy. Talking about Will Smith.
Yes, yes. I don't think we're going to stop talking about this, honestly, in some way or another, but maybe not in a heightened way. But what I think about it is I'm saying to myself, I'm watching this and I'm saying to myself, my goodness, where's this coming from? He looks like reacting as opposed to thinking about this is something that I really want to do here. And I know exactly why I'm going to do it. Everybody's seen, I'm sure, the clip of him laughing first, and then you see Jada's face, and then the next thing you see is him going up the stairs. So I just finished Will's book, and he talks about the trauma of not being there for his mother to defend his mother, right, in domestic violence. And so I'm saying, did he look at Jada's face in that flashback? I'm being a coward again. And then he decided he was going to do something, or he just went with the emotions. But I'm going to tell you the thing, because it's about my work. Chris Rock in that moment, how, what did you do, brother? That's what I want to know. Like, what did you do to bring yourself to the, like, that's that, sell that, yeah. Sell that to folks. Because how did you bring yourself in that moment to not just carry on, but to do it in a way where you have to be in shock in that moment, and yet you are totally professional and you actually let Will off with real grace, right? Because that kind of turned into throwing hands and just something that I don't think any of us wanted to imagine what that could have been.
I thought it was a movie smack.
Yeah, I think a lot of people did first because it was kind of like that, right? But but you had to, when you saw Chris's reaction, I think that's like the initial, right, the reaction. And that's why I say, what did he do for himself in that moment? Because it was clear that he was not expecting that. He fully felt it. And Will was on something in terms of adrenaline and feelings, and because he didn't come out of it, and he went back down, and we get the cursing and my wife's name, like it continued on.
What did he say? My wife's name? What? No,
keep
you don't have
my,
to.
Good. All right. Keep my. I wasn't going to. But keep my wife's name out your mouth. Yeah. Yes, and several times, right? Yeah.
But so, I thought Chris Rock was so cool. Chris was cool after that. I mean, he had to grab his composure back, you know, because he did say we're giving out the documentary. I mean, the award to the documentary. So he was like startled.
Yeah,
you do a lot of this kind of work. Tell us about the other types of work that you do to help others get what they need out of life. I mean, you're working with women, entrepreneurs. Tell us about that.
I do. I work with women, entrepreneurs. I do conflict coaching. So I work a lot with leadership. So whether it's one-on-one coaching or whether I work in groups in different corporations and nonprofits and really helping people to look at how you respond in conflict. And it isn't just about techniques. It's about what's happening within you. During conflict, and how do you work with that in order to get the best result?
And all those other things that lead up to that point, those other things that you need? Do you need to get to the root of your situation?
Yes.
Can fix it.
That's right. I did a conflict summit about old wounds and conflict because they're sitting there, right? And we have the trauma and the residue of old wounds from childhood on up. However, whoever raised you did conflict, you learn to do that too. And until you do something to unlearn that, right? And you've got to do a lot of something and get more techniques, you are going to likely do the same kinds of things when conflicts come up. I also work with a group called On the Matter of Race, and I work with white people who are interested in learning about racism and doing something about it. And that is not just learning history, but also, what about me? Like, how do I uphold it? And what was I raised with? And how do I then unlearn that and challenge that in the way in which I operate in the world? And that's not easy work at all, to look at our own selves and to really see where we need to learn more and unlearn more and do better.
What are some of the things that you can do? I mean, a couple of tips that you can do or tell people to help de-escalate a situation.
Yeah. Well, first thing is, people have no idea how powerful our breath is. It's one of the things that we can control within ourselves. And so I know I grew up on, you know, like count to 10 and breathe, but that's really not what I'm talking about. What I'm talking about is being able to use the breath to de-escalate us, because our physiology acts first in any conflict situation. So we have to get to it, get ourselves to the place of being able to be being able to access our brain, right? Decision-making ability. So the breath is one thing. The other thing is, once you're in that space, to really think about whether or not this is something that you really want to do. This is the best thing that I can do in this situation. And I'll say, you may really may want to slap the mess out of somebody, but is that the best thing in the situation? And is that who you are? And is that, are you ready to deal with whatever's on the other side that solution? Like,
right. It took me a That's long right. time.
Think about the consequences.
Did it? Yeah. A long time.
Yeah. Yeah, because that slap feels good, right? Yeah. If you're honest with yourself, but that's not the right response, right? And if that is not who you are, especially, right, then you've altered this moment in time. And you look at Will Smith, he altered this moment in time, and he can't get that back.
Tell us about the before technique.
Yeah, before, that's the technique. I thought about this just really when this situation came up, because these are the kinds of things that I use. So,
and what does this stand for?
It stands for, the breath is B, right? So breathing in and then holding it for 4 seconds and then exhale for 4 seconds, right? Beautiful, right? So that's the E. And then you have to really go from there to think about like what is it that you're feeling? Yeah. And feel the feelings, sit in the feelings. We run away from feelings. I want you to sit in the feelings and to really understand, right? And then the O is, you know, to own what it's making you want to do, right? Whatever that is. And then, you know, after that, to reflect, the R, reflect on, is that the best solution to this? Mm-hmm. And then the E is about, what's the best, the excellent thing that I can do that's going to represent me well in this moment?
And therefore, so you're before.
Before. And do it before.
Do it before.
Do it before.
Exactly. Yes. Where can we find more about all the work that you're doing?
You can find me at Lynn. Yes, my website, LynnMaureenHurdle.com. I'm also on Instagram at Conflict Closer. I don't tweet a lot, but I am on Twitter. I'm on LinkedIn as Lynn Maureen Hurdle. You can find me in all those places.
And you'll help them get over their hurdle.
Yes, for a price.
For a price.
I heard a price.
Everything's in the name right there.
That's right. It's so all there.
Lynn Hurdle Price, CEO, Conflict Resolution Analyst, Specialist. It's a beautiful thing.
Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you. We'll take a break. More Open coming your way next. Don't move.
We built a media network for you.
Bronxnet TV.
Come learn in your new state-of-the-art studios at Lehman College.
At Mercy College.
And coming soon to the South Bronx in the Hub.
Inspire with your stories, culture, history.
Your Bronx on Bronxnet.
Engage with us.
Connect with us at your channels and at Bronxnet.tv.
Learn, engage, inspire. Bronxnet TV.
From the Bronx
to the world.
Bronxnet.
back, everybody. I'm the Doc Bob Lee from 107.5 WBLS, and you're watching Open. Our next guest is the president and owner of Kolstein's Music Incorporated. He joins us today to speak about his journey into the music world and how Kolstein's has helped him in his pursuit as a musician. So please welcome to the show, Manny Alvarez. Manny, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Lee. I really appreciate you taking the time out of your day to have a conversation with me.
Oh, no problem. Manny, I heard you've been into this music business or in this music world for some time now. Tell us how it all started.
That's right. Yes. Well, you know, I'm first born, first generation Latino in the country. So my mother is from Central America, my father from South America. And in school, in the third grade, we had a orchestral quartet come in. We had a bassist, a violinist, a cellist, and a violist, and they played music for the third graders. And the violin just so captured me that I went up to the teacher and I asked if I could join the orchestra. I grabbed my permission slip, brought it home, and spoke to my parents about it. And they were very confused. They didn't know where this came from or how this how it all goes down when you take music lessons in school. But that from that moment, it really started to change my life and put me on a path to learn more about music and what it does. And it brought me to where I am today.
Yeah. And you're a first generation Latin person, Latin man.
That's right. Right, right.
Where are you from?
My mother's from El Salvador. My dad's from Ecuador. I was born here. But they came when they were a little bit older. So a lot of the things that I have gone through or my family and I have gone through were learned experiences. Everything was a first for us.
Yeah.
And how to navigate through the waters of school and you know, education and business and all the different ways to navigate through the system of our society.
A lot of
it was all new.
Did you go through a lot
absolutely.
Of
absolutely. Yeah. There was a lot of things that we had to go through. We didn't know what matriculation was in college. So we didn't know what student loans were. We thought that you had to pay for things, you know, out of pocket. And so university looked like out of the picture for me. And that we didn't learn. No one taught me what the SATs were. I thought that colleges just send you letters in the mail saying that you're accepted if you want to come based on your high school transcripts. I didn't know you needed to apply or take a test. And so through a series of events, you learn, you go through these things and you have the experience. And then that's something that you can pass on for another generation. But what music did for me is it really changed my moments. Playing music helped me forget everything and just focus on the music and focus on the notes. And that really helped me get through some of those difficult moments in life.
Yeah, well, Sandra DaCosta and the Bullion Foundation helps out with that also. They back you every step of the way.
They're amazing. She's absolutely incredible. And what they do is great as well. And everyone that they work with is really so super helpful.
So the violin was your instrument of choice.
That's right. Yeah. It brought me into Kolstein Music in Baldwin. It's a 79-year-old organization, started in 1943. And I walked in to buy my first instruments. Unfortunately, it was a little bit over budget for my family. So I said, I'm sorry, it was $3,500. And my family said, absolutely not. That's way too much. And I came back and said, I'm sorry, I love it, but I can't afford it. And I ended up walking away with a job, packing rosin in the back, which is a product you put on bows to play the instruments, and sweeping the floors. And that was about 18 years ago.
Wow. And now you look back and say, hey, look at some of the things that I had to go through in order to get where I am today. And you're
That's
moving
right.
on. Well, big up to your organization, Kolstein's, and the whole crew there. You want to give some of them a shout out? Or Absolutely.
Absolutely. It wouldn't be, we wouldn't be anywhere we are if it wasn't for the entire team. We have from our marketing directors and audiovisual specialists to our luthiers from Italy or from Poland or from many different parts of the world. We're an international staff of people that just really have a passion and dedication for string musical instruments. We specialize in violins, violas, cellos, and basses, and their bows. So we do a lot with Carnegie Hall, Players, Lincoln Center, New York Philharmonic. We are always doing business and fully support the Juilliard School, Manhattan School of Music, and a lot of the other music universities and orchestras from around the world. It's really exciting. And we actually just December 1st opened our second location. Our primary one is in Baldwin, Long Island. We've been here over 15 years. And then we just opened
Exit 21, something like that, off the southern state, right? Something
yes, like that's right. Yeah, 21. Yeah. 20S. Yeah.
20S.
And then and now we just opened a new one at 153 West 58th Street in Manhattan. We're the only street front string instrument shop in all of New York City. We have like 11 storefront windows, two main entrances, and we are proudly inside of the Essex House Hotel on 160 Central Park South. So
wow. Yeah.
Really, really wonderful.
That hotel has a lot of history too.
It really does.
Manny, so you're not only a musician, but you're an entrepreneur, you're a businessman.
That's right. Yeah. I was very blessed and honored to 2.5 years ago be able to purchase this company from the former owner, Barry Kolstein. His father started the company, Samuel Kolstein, in 1943.
Has the pandemic hindered you in any way?
Oh, absolutely. It was, as we all went through, we didn't know what tomorrow would bring. So that was very, very difficult to navigate to. One of the things that we did was people stopped buying, stopped spending money on instruments or repairs, restorations, et cetera. Yeah. So we transitioned quickly into starting something called the Kolstein Musician Relief Fund. That fund was to help our clients and our industry. And 3 months after the shutdown, we were meeting in person with musicians, and we were recording their performances and paying them to perform. Every week we had a live stream, as sometimes we'd reach 5,000 to 10,000 people on the live stream that we would help the musicians put out, pay them, feed them, and we continued that still to this day.
I'm loving it. I like that. So there are a lot of musicians out there that were out of work. I was in contact with a few of them too. And they said, we can't contribute to your foundation to make the Great Foundation for Education this year because, you know, we're not working like we're used to. So when we get back on track, we'll continue to help you out. But so a lot of people were going through that. So what I started doing, like what you're doing, I started helping people with like different things, you know. No need to bring up any names or anything like that. You just do what you have to do during a crisis. And we love what you're doing. So thank you so much.
No, thank you, Dr. Lee.
Where can we go to find out more about everything that you're doing? You have a nice website that we can log on to?
We do. Yeah. You can go to www.kolstein.com. That shows you all the information that we have. And also find us on Facebook at facebook.com/S Kolstein.
How about Instagram?
Instagram, yes. We have instagram.com/Kolstein Music. And the thing for our YouTube channel.
Follow me and I'll follow you. I'm D-O-C-B-O-B-L-E-E, Doc Bob Lee on Instagram. Spell out the whole doc on all the other platforms, Dr.
Okay. Yeah. That's good.
Hey, thank you so much, man. And you're always welcome to come back and maybe bring the violin next time and get busy.
You got it.
I absolutely see it back there. Wait, it's over in the corner over there.
That is the one I bought. That's the one I came in for. That's right. That's the one I came in for.
Thank you so much. We appreciate
Thank you, Dudley.
We appreciate you, man.
Thank you.
Manny Alvarez. Yes. Kolstein's Music Incorporated. President, musician, president, and owner of Kolstein's Music Incorporated. We appreciate you, man.
Thank you.
All right. We'll take a break right here. Don't move a muscle. We'll come back and give you more. We're giving it away right here on Open. Everybody, our next guest is the Vice President of Marketing, and she joins us today to highlight the New York City Football Club's recent jersey launch and to speak about their chances of repeating as MLS champions. Yay! Woo! Please welcome to the show, Sara Bishop. Sara, welcome.
Thank you for having me. It's great to be back.
Yes, nice to see you again. But now we have something different to talk about. Are you going to repeat again this year?
I mean, fingers crossed. We can only hope that we will continue to make our fans proud and bring some more silverware back home to the Bronx.
There you go. That's what I'm talking about. Hey, tell us more about the New York City Vault away jerseys for the NYC.
Yes.
NYC.
We're very excited to have our new kit. Launched earlier this year, we released the new jersey. It's called the Volt Kit, which serves as our away jersey for our 2022 and 2023 seasons. I will give you a peek. This jersey looks like it is incredibly different from previous years. Obviously, as you can see, it's orange, which is a huge deviation from our standard city blue.
Yes.
It's definitely a fan favorite, and fans of the team have long been asking for this orange colorway. So we're so proud that it's here. A little bit of background behind the kit from a storytelling perspective. Really, it's inspired by our supporters and our supporters, as I'm sure you know, or any of your viewers who have been to an NYCFC game know, they really create that electric atmosphere at matches. They're the source of passion and energy from the club. They're loud, they're in your face. And so I think this kit is a perfect embodiment of what that supporter culture means to us. And we're very
blessed,
as you mentioned, to now have a star over the badge, signifying our MLS Cup champion win last year.
Hey, congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you. So,
once again, who inspired the color scheme behind the new jerseys?
Orange is actually in our NYCFC club color scheme. We've never had it prominently featured though on a jersey or really prominently featured on any of our fan wear until this year. But we definitely have several fans that 4 years have been making their own merch with Orange and have been representing from the supporter section with Orange on for a while. So we're really excited that we get to kind of be loud and in your face about bringing this new colorway to life. Yes.
So coming off of this championship, what are the expectations for 2022? I won't tell anybody.
Yes. Well, our season is already underway. Our first competitive game was in the CONCACAF Champions League, which is an intercontinental competition that we actually qualified for as reigning MLS Cup champions. And we couldn't be more proud of what the boys in blue are doing out there on the pitch. We've progressed through the first two rounds against sides from Costa Rica and Guatemala. We're actually now in the semifinals for the first time in club history and are facing a fellow MLS club, Seattle, for a spot in the final. So for any of our NYCFC fans, we're playing against Seattle in Seattle on April 9th and our home leg on April 13th at Red Bull Arena. So we would love to have people come out and make sure that we're supporting our boys in blue, but already off to a very, very strong start from a season perspective, which we're really excited about. And really our goal for the season is to capitalize on that momentum of being champions and continue to bring more silverware back home for our fans.
There you go. You have some of the same players, well, most of the same players playing for you, right?
Yep. We still have a really strong squad that the team feels very confident in. And we've seen some great performances already in the Bronx. We're back in our regular MLS Cup season, MLS season rather, in the Bronx on April 17th against Real Salt Lake, who we also played in the playoffs of last year. So it will definitely be exciting to continue to watch the guys perform out there as they carry the championship with them.
Oh, that's going to be a goodie. All right. That's like a repeat of what happened last year. Here we go. But we're going to win.
Obviously. Yeah. Fingers crossed, but we feel confident.
Yeah, we got to get the producers and everybody. Maybe we can come and visit and check that game out.
Absolutely. We would love to have you there.
Yeah. All right. Anything that we should know about? How can we get you have a shop where people can buy cups and t-shirts and merch?
Yes. If you want one of these beautiful jerseys, you can visit the MLS store, mlsstore.com/NYCFC.
Last time out, we got a chance to speak with NFL up-and-comer Chase Edmonds. Not his first go-around here on BronxNet. Back in 2016, we featured him in the Crusader Cup. Check this out.
This is Bobby C. at Yankee Stadium, and the Bronx sports story of the week, years in the making as Fordham and Holy Cross renew their football rivalry at Yankee Stadium for the first time since November of 1923. The Rams took it to the Crusaders. Final score here at Yankee Stadium, 54-14, highlighted by four touchdowns from the star running back Chase Edmonds, who secured his 59th career touchdown in Patriot League play. That is a record. We caught up with Chase on the field after the game. You've done so well against Holy Cross during your time here, and obviously in big games. I mean, how special was it to be here at Yankee Stadium today and have another great performance?
It was great. You know, it was everything that you just dreamed about, the experience and more. You know, I'm so proud of the team, though, that we came out and dominated like we needed to do. We're really trying to make a push for the playoffs, and we got to show that we can be a dominant team, and this is a great start.
Going into the game, we knew, about Chase. We've seen him for the two prior years, and he's always given us and everyone else trouble. I think he's one of the best backs, if not the best back, I've ever seen in the Patriot League, and I mean in the history of the Patriot League.
Fordham's running back and quarterback both had big days. Kevin Anderson threw for three touchdowns and 426 yards.
It was very special to me. I had 40 of my closest family and friends come up from the game, and a lot of people in my life that are really close to me that have never seen me play in person. So it was huge for me, and I was super excited just to play in front of them and just let them see me play and all the hard work I've had.
When you decided to become a Ram, did you ever think that you'd get an opportunity to play at Yankee Stadium?
No, never even crossed my mind in a million years. And it's just a great experience, man. It's great to be in New York City and be able to do things like this, and you want to just take full advantage of it.
We flash forward 2 years to 2019, where the hometown kid has three touchdowns against the New York Giants. Here's more with Chase Edmonds.
Extremely stoked, man. Again, you know, coming back here, being a small school guy, I already had a chip on my shoulder, and obviously Saquon was coming back, and I knew it was going to be an electric atmosphere, so I just wanted to go out here and show people, you know, make a name for myself. Really, I'm still a second-year player just trying to make a name for myself in this league. And Fordham was such a small school, so I never really got crazy media hype in college, but you know, again, it's a blessing just to be able to come back here, man. Everything went full circle for me. And come here in front of all these people, in front of my family, my friends, and just be able to have the game that I had. Great blocking. I mean, you've seen the first two. I mean, it was really one where I broke a tackle, but, I mean, it was literally a good cut. Line had a great job opening lanes, and they did a great job of just really dominating the line of scrimmage, especially where you have a game like this. It's raining. You know they're going to stack the box. It's going to be hard earned yards, and they did a great job. Always want more. You know, my cup's never full. That's what Larry always taught us, man. And always want more. Going to go back to the drawing board and find ways to get better.
And now here's part two of our interview with newest Miami Dolphin and former Fordham great, Chase Edmonds.
Oh, you're always welcome. I mean, I was actually hoping I could maybe recruit you to come play for the Giants or the Jets. You had some of your best games in the NFL at MetLife Stadium. I thought there might be something to playing in New York, Chase.
I know, man. I mean, I at least get to see MetLife though once a year, so that's okay.
Yeah, and obviously torture Giants or Jets fans when you're here. No doubt about it. Well, I mean, I figured we could do a little speed round here before we let you go. I was thinking, you know, you mentioned about getting together with some teammates and was wondering what that maybe favorite hangout spot from the college days was. Was it a place like Arthur Avenue, or was there some other place that you like to go with the guys?
In the city, yo, I cannot remember the name of this restaurant, but my 21st birthday, I know it was right before I was about to get drafted. Kevin Anderson and like three of my other college teammates took me out to this restaurant, and I can't remember the name. I can't even remember where we were going, but I know that it was like an $80. You get an entree, appetizer, and all you can drink wine for $80. And I just remember going there, man. And that was the best spot. We always go there. We went there like probably once every like 3 months, 4 months, but it was so far, and it'd always be a good time because it was all you could drink wine for like 2 hours sit down. So, you know, we were going at it. We were going for it. But the spot around campus, I got to say, one that just that hits my mind for whatever reason is Burger Lodge and Simon's Deli, because Simon's Deli, we used to live on the Arthur Ave house, and Simon's Deli was literally like a 100-yard walk. And I remember we would just take turns, the boys in the house, of taking turns of getting milkshakes for everybody. And you would never want to be the one to get selected in the winter because it was so cold. That walk would be brutal. And then the milkshakes, you hold the milkshakes in your hand or whatever, you're freezing. And then Burger Lodge was just fire. The burgers on there, oh man, I haven't been there in so long. I got to get back.
was it like a pregame meal, Chase, or something that you did that you would get ready for the games at Rose Hill? Or was something that you wanted to eat before the games?
Nah, it never really was. It was just the pregame meals with the guys and the team, but that's something I always cherish.
Now, I know you speak of the word cherish again before we let you go. I know being a girl dad is very, very important to you. I was hoping that you could speak about family and then also some of the charities that you've been connected to that have to do with being a girl dad.
Yeah, so last year I worked with Girls Inc. Incorporated. That's just really about raising young girls, making sure that, you know, they're intelligent, strong, and they kind of just have the knowledge that they need to succeed in this world. And that's something I hold dear to my heart, man, just because with Avery, you know, I was 18 when Avery was born. Just to be able, when I realized and remember, like, the moments of when I scrolled through my phone of how young and how little Avery was, and it was like when she was in the locker room with the guys or when Kevin was holding her, and just to see the development of her now, man. She's 7. You know, she just turned 7 March 8th. And, you know, 7 going on 12. Like, it's crazy, these kids, how much more they develop they are than when I was a kid. You know what I'm saying? Just, like, the knowledge they have about the world and what's going on with the world. But just, man, being a girl dad to me is just it's the most humbling thing, a humbling experience in the greatest way, just because in every decision that I make now, man, you know, Avery's always in my mind. Avery's always on my mind. Like, how would my daughter look at me if she saw her dad doing this, or, you know, had her dad talking like this, or whatever the case may be, man? It just, it really humbles you. It makes you really aware of just your words, your actions, and how you treat people, especially females.
Yeah, I mean, that was something that NBA great Kobe Bryant would always say. I mean, definitely powerful stuff there, Chase.
Yeah, appreciate it.
Well, I mean, before, you know, in closing, I guess here officially, I guess I was going to give you a chance to give that push to maybe the fans at home as to why this will be a big year, whether it's in fantasy or reality.
Man, I just, you know, I think the work you put in always comes to light. And I believe that, you know, I'm going to get to work this year, this offseason. I'm very excited for the opportunity. And, you know, I can't wait to get it started, man. Fins up.
Congratulations again on the big deal, man. Again, as I said, very well deserved. And for the fans at home, go out and get this man for your fantasy team. He is definitely the real one.
I appreciate you, bro. Thank you.
Thanks again for coming on the show, Chase.
Yes, sir. Appreciate you for having me, for real.
We built a media network for you.
BronxNet TV.
Come learn in your new state-of-the-art studios at Lehman College.
At Mercy College.
And coming soon to the South Bronx in the Hub.
Inspire with your stories, culture, history.
Your Bronx on BronxNet.
Engage with us.
Connect with us at your channels and at BronxNet.tv.
Learn, engage, inspire. BronxNet TV.
From the Bronx
to the world.
BronxNet.
Taking public transportation, don't touch your phone. carry hand sanitizer, and use it immediately upon leaving the bus or train. Avoid touching your face. If someone is coughing or sneezing, move away. Wash your hands with soap and water as soon as possible. Limit contact with poles. If possible, avoid rush hour. Don't eat or drink on public transportation. Keep your bag off the floor or other surfaces. Avoid directly touching turnstiles. Stay up to date with the latest from your local health department and CDC.
Dr. Bob Lee, welcome back, everybody. Our last guest is the Deputy Director of the Van Cortlandt Park Alliance, and she's here today to speak about her organization's upcoming 22 and 22 Park event and a whole lot more. So please welcome to the show, Christina Taylor. Christina, how are you? Nice to see you again.
I'm doing great. Great to see you again.
So 22 and 22? We talked about 1 and 22, but tell us all about 22 and 22.
So we are challenging everyone to get out into Van Cortlandt Park and to hike, run, bike, skip, whatever you want to do, 22 miles in Van Cortlandt Park this year. So this is an initiative that we did last year in order to encourage people to get into the park, and it was really well received. So we brought it back and added another mile for the new year.
There you go. You can do another mile. Why not?
What's another mile?
Yeah, what's another mile? It's a hop, skip, and a jump. Christina, there's a whole lot going on in the park, and that's one of the things. Tell us about some of the other programs that you offer.
Sure, we have a lot of other things happening in the park. We do community stewardship days, so we have a lot of volunteer events coming up to help maintain the trails that you'll be walking on in 22 and 22, and to maintain the forest. So we do trail work Wednesdays and forest Fridays, and then we have several on weekends community volunteer events doing various activities to help take care of the natural areas of the park. Yeah. And in addition to that, we have cultural programs. So we have our barefoot dancing series coming up. So we'll have a weekday evening in May and one in June where people can come out to the back deck of the Van Cortlandt Golf House and kick off their shoes and dance to some local music.
Ah, I like it. All right. You have a DJ or a band?
We have a band. So the first one will be in May, and that's Juan Hiosera and the Sambuco tribe. They will be doing Bamba, and then we have another artist coming. We're still firming up the details for June.
That guy's going to be the hot. You want the Bamba?
Yeah. He's a lot of fun. He was in the park last fall, and everyone really enjoyed it, so we're really excited to welcome him back.
Yeah, and that's a wonderful atmosphere, too. I like that back deck with the water, and you see the swans back and the ducks.
And then we'll be back there in May for our annual benefit, our springtime fete.
Well, you make sure you let BronxNet know so we can come down with some cameras or put on our dancing shoes.
You actually already are. we've already scheduled that.
Yeah, it's scheduled already, huh?
Yeah, it's in the books.
So all we need to do is bring our dancing shoes, right, Christina?
That's all you need to do, yeah. You'll be ready to go.
Plenty of food?
Plenty of food. Our benefit will have plenty of food, yep. That's a promise.
Listen, how will the COVID mandate, those changes, how will they impact the event attendance?
So we were able to safely do an event last year during COVID, and we're hoping that, fingers crossed, everything will stay as it has been, hopefully the numbers won't rise and we'll be able to do it again. The good thing with our benefit is the vast majority of it is outdoors. And all of our events, actually, they're outdoors. So it's easy to, you know, get fresh air and to practice social distancing. And, you know, we take all the precautions we need to take.
Beautiful. Christina, out of all the programs that you mentioned, what's the one that's closer to your heart? You may have two or three.
I mean, personally, I really like 22 and 22. I really enjoy getting out and hiking in the park. That's, you know, one of the perks of my job is to get out into the park and you know, to see the different trails and to walk through the different natural areas. It's just, you know, it's peaceful for me to be out in the woods and going for a walk. So any of our hiking programs are really my favorite. And this, you know, this program is really nice because you can do it on your own schedule. You get out there and go for a hike when you want to, but we also are leading some guided hikes. So I'll be doing one just for people who sign up for 22 and 22 in May, where they can come out and we'll take them for a walk. Because I know not everyone's comfortable walking through areas they don't know on their own. So this is a way to introduce them to some new areas of the park.
Yeah, I would love to do that. Maybe get the producer and a few of us, a few of the people from the team, and maybe we can get out there and get there and do that little walk before the walk, before the 22. Right.
Yeah, so the 22 and 22 is going on. You can sign up now and you basically have the entire year to hit your 22 miles. But at any point that you guys want to come out and join us and do a walk, we're more than happy to give you a guided tour.
I love that. I love that. We'll get some information and everything. We'll try to latch on to one or two of those. And then you have other summer events all throughout the summer, right?
Summer, a lot of the summer is spent working with our high school interns. So I know Pauline was on the show last week to talk about the urban eco teams. We also have our garden to market internship. And then we do a lot of volunteer programs during the weekdays during the summer.
Yeah, I like that. I like working with the high school students because they get a chance to learn a lot and they get a chance to work. They can make money, right? They have jobs.
This is, you know, for a lot of them, it's their first job, which is really great that they, you know, get the experience what it means to earn your own paycheck.
Exactly. So remind us again, what's some of the experience that they, what are the students going to learn while working in the park?
I think one thing they definitely learn is just an understanding and a respect for nature that maybe they don't really comprehend or think about on their own initially. Even like a lot of the interns later will come back and say, well, I don't litter anymore because now I realize what an impact it has on the environment. You know, it's really opening their eyes to that and understanding that nature needs our help, especially in urban areas. You know, plants and the animals can't just be out there on their own. There's a lot of negative influences, a lot of, you know, things that we need to help out to maintain those natural areas. So I think it's just really eye-opening for them to see how much work actually goes into maintaining a park.
And of course, they're going to learn a lot about the plants and the animals and everything that interacts, everything working together in harmony, moving together in the same direction for a common cause. Exactly. Nature. Yes. Well, thank you so much for joining us, and you're always welcome to come back. Did we miss anything? Would you like to mention anything that we missed?
I just want to let people know that for 22 and 22, if you sign up and register, there is a fee. But once you register, you do get some giveaways. So you'll get your own Van Cortlandt Park Alliance backpack. You'll get a sticker and a map. And then when you finish, you'll get a patch. So this is last year's patch. So it says 21 and 21, but you'll get one that's slightly redesigned, says 22 and 22. So you can wear it with pride and you can brag about the fact that you accomplished your 22.
I'm ready. What type of sneaker should I wear?
I would suggest some good hiking, sturdy sneakers. That if you have little higher ones that go around the ankles, that's always good because our trails are not, you know, all completely flat. So that's helpful to have ankle support. Bring some water and a snack. And you could, you know, we have 20 miles of hiking trail that you can go out and explore. Visit our website, vancortlandt.org, and you can sign up.
Well, thank you so much. I'm going to get my, see if I can get a good pair of sneakers with grips on the bottom. And get a bottle for
be prepared to maybe get muddy depending, especially if you go after it rains. It's all part of the fun though.
Hey, if you're in it and you love it, that's what you're passionate about, it this is what we're gonna do.
Exactly.
So 22 and 22.
Yep.
Like Chuck Willowy, 2 and 2.
There you go.
Thank you so much, Christina.
Thank you so much for having me.
Nice talking to you again. Christina Taylor, Deputy Director of Van Cortlandt Park Alliance. We love you guys out there. You want to shout anybody out there? No, they're going to be watching. Want to give a quick shout out?
I just say hi to all the Van Cortlandt Park Alliance staff and all the New York City Parks Department staff who've been working really hard over the last couple of years to maintain the park and keeping it beautiful. We appreciate it, everyone.
Thank you. Thank you for all the work that you guys are doing, maintaining our parks. Thank you. The Alliance.
All right. Go Alliance.
All right. All right, that about does it for me, the Doc Bob Lee. And hey, it's always a tough time when you're having fun and you're getting some great information out there. But always remember this, what you are is God's gift to you. What you make of yourself is your gift to God. So choose your choice. Let your choice control the chooser. I'll see you over 107.5 WBLS tonight. And for all of us here at BronxNet, have a great and enjoyable day. We love you all. Peace.